Okay, and this is the covenant of Shalom.
Let's see, well, okay, so the connection has been made. Book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 11, is the establishing of the kingdom, right? So,
Right.
Sukkot,
Yes, you called.
allotted to the authority of the Father.
Right.
Principle, you know, like, foremostly, but expressed, no doubt, through the Son as well.
Yeah, over this.
So what I was trying to get to Joseph was the blessings and how the lion is symbolically represented in the covenant. That is the flag
Which blessing?
of Rastafari. Well, it's Yaakov's, right? But then the blessing that's allotted to
Oh.
Yosef. So it'd be chapter 49 of the book of Genesis. So it begins, let's see, Judah, and this is, we got to keep in mind that I'm trying to incorporate into this context Judaism, an expression of, in its time, the living word, but then. When the time of the seasons to change,
Right.
then it must either remain living in the spirit, the prophecy of time, or become a dead letter, like indoctrinated, limited.
True.
So, after saying that, we could go forth and says, Chapter 49, verse 8, Judah, Yehuda, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. And I just gotta add, like, we always have to, like, keep in mind that even though it's an eternal reflection of the Father and the Son and the Son and the Father being one, some of these things are allotted specifically in the authority of one or the other.
Right.
So, saying that, goes on to say, Judah, Yehuda is a lion's whelp. So now we get the lion symbolism from the prey. My son, thou art gone up. He stooped down, he couched down. Oh no, he couched as a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up? Rouse him up. Excuse, I got a little bit of cottonmouth there.
Yeah, that's cool.
But so I mean, I don't want to go into that because I'm not prepared, probably. But it seems like there's a reflection of the young lion in Jesus Christos. Could that be possible? And the old line, who shall rise? Because
Yeah, he look,
he's already enthroned. Who can rise him
there's a
up?
whole very good study on this that I don't even know if I yeah, I didn't publish it too.
He's in Cushan. He's in Zion, in his resting or established locale. Who's gonna rise him up?
Right. Let
You
me.
know, he's got his hand over his enemies, his Yad. That name called upon in triumph. Ever connected in praise, praise ye Jah, praise ye Yah, and then the Elilta, the Hallel, the Elelelelelelelele. So that's very interesting. But okay, I'm gonna go forward because I'm just trying to stick to the flag. Let's see. The scepter.
The scepter.
The scepter, that's what it is, my bad. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, the government. Shall not depart from Yehuda, from the praises of Jah. Rastafari. So it's, it goes forth saying, the scepter shall not depart from Yehuda, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, and to him shall the gathering of the people be. Sukkot, right?
Right. The ingathering.
The ingathering. Allotted in the authority of the Father, although ever present in the Son. Amen.
This is so much right here that we...
And so going forth, let's see. I don't know. Even though this is prophecy, I mean, it's possible that the hoof was split and the cud was, the cud was chewed, man. Cause Jesus Christos fulfills like a lamb covenant, kind of, even though it's expressed in a lion, in a young lion form, kind of.
Yeah, the study. Let me see.
But let me just go forward. That's kind of like,
yeah. That's going off the point.
That's going off the point. You're right. So going forward, I mean, the scepter, the rein, binding his foal to the vine, and his ass's colt to the choice vine. Mm-hmm. He washed his garments in wine and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes shall be red with wine and his teeth white with milk.
It's right there between, but the verses, okay, that already connected because this is Sukkot because of the ingathering and the scepter, which is the government, so that would connect to the flag.
The flag.
Right.
Give thanks for that.
No doubt. Jeremiah, and then I think Jeremiah goes into the banners too. Mm. I'm not sure.
It most likely probably would. Although at the present moment, I can't really like recall any direct mentions to it. Mm.
Let me check it.
And so the flag, the government, the kingdom, the Sukkot, the ingathering to whom all nations, the pendant, the ensign, the standard, to whom all nations, all peoples shall seek to. Actually, I'll go forward to Isaiah chapter 11 once again to properly state that. And the Psalms goes into a lot of the pendants also. So how the kingdom will be set up, and in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. So it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious, like a crouching lion. Who shall arouse him? Like a couching lion. Then going forward onto, and he shall set up an ensign for the nations, and shall assemble the outcast of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah. So if the covenant is in symbolically represented in the lion. Mm. Then we add to it. We could go to Numbers and see how Judah and the lion, to whom the authority has been handed over, maintains the covenant represented in the Rastafari flag, the Ethiopian flag, mm-hmm. which we share inheritance to. So the book of Numbers, if I'm not mistaken, it would be chapter 1 or 2. But to not take up...
Hey, Numbers chapter 1 or 2.
Around there. Hold up. Chapter 2, watch. The order of the host, arrangement of the camp. And the Lord spake to Moses and to Aaron, saying, Every man of the children of Israel shall pitch by his own standard, with the ensign of their father's house. Mm-hmm. Far off about the tabernacle of the congregation shall they pitch. In verse 3 it reads, And on the east side, on the rising of the sun, on the Kedem, even Kedem.
Yeah, in the Kedem.
The side towards the rising of the sun, even that sun of righteousness, that shines Jesus Christos, I would say. And there's evidence to support that. It's in the book of Malachi, how it's the sun of righteousness is it's more leaning towards the authority of the Father, I would say. There's supporting evidence there. We could check that out later. Okay. So it goes on. Continue saying that, and on the east side towards the rising of the sun, shall they of the standard of the camp of Judah pitch throughout their armies. And so to Judah have been given like the government, really, and in this sense, I mean, it's prophetic. It's not so much, but it's in faith.
Right.
And so Judah, keeping the blessing and its resemblance of a lion. So to the east, at the rising, whenever Israel would march forward, they'd be headed by that same standard.
Right.
The covenant of Noah, represented in the ark, the bow, that's that sign of that covenant. Mm-hmm. Which is of faith, light, Ritawahido, the fusion of the word, and stuff like that. So Numbers chapter, let's see, I think it was chapter 10. And it came to pass on the 20th day of the second month in the second year that the cloud... So we have a cloud, and it's funny because it's by fire by night and shadow by day, right? And that cloud, in which was probably the light, that same covenant, you know, represented in the sevenfold frequencies that make up the visible light. Mm. So, I mean, that's interesting, but nonetheless, so on the 20th day of the second month in the second year, that the cloud was taken up from off the tabernacle of the testimony, and the children of Israel took their journeys out of the wilderness of Sinai, and that cloud rested in the wilderness of Paran. That wasn't necessarily what I wanted to read. When am I saying, do you remember do you recall like where it is in the book of Numbers that Judah stands up and marches forward? It's like pretty near to this.
Even when the camp sets out?
Oh yeah, so I should have just kept on reading, excuse that. And they first took their journey according to the commandment of the Lord by the hand of Moses. In the first place went the standard of the camp of the children of Judah according to their armies. So spearheading like the march is that standard,
right?
And so I mean I think it'd be pretty acceptable that the transfer of government is already in the hands of Judah, really.
Yeah, it definitely is,
like leading the armies of the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness. March. And no doubt the symbology, I mean, even if actually manifested on the flag in that space-time continuum, you know, in that moment in the spirit of prophecy, whether the line was on the flag or not, the word symbolically upholds the line in that standard that holds the covenant at the first rising, carried by the tribe of Judah, Yehuda. And so, that lion in the living spirit would have to be represented in the authority of the Father in his allotted time. And then I guess it would be like wise to just kind of point out that this is where kind of like some of the other doctrines get it right and wrong and confusing, that Jesus Christus came in to represent that conquering lion, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So
he was the lamb.
The lamb, right?
Right.
So even though he was of the tribe of Yehuda,
right?
That was in the his allotted authority, right?
No, he just said, I mean, that's what the studies would point to, because he would fulfill Passover, you know, like Sukkot is not fulfilled until it's like, it's a shadow.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, I mean, going forward, just to like settle the matter with the flag, I mean, this last section of the standard, it would be the fulfillment in Judah and Edomawi Chad Selassie, in prevailing to carry the standard, really. I mean, it doesn't matter what people want to believe, however it happened, symbolically or materialistically. I mean, people throw out some weird ideas out there, whatever people want to think. This standard has been only upheld by certain people, and it's represented in the independence of that certain people raising a single standard for such a long time, the same flag or standard which they were willing to die for,
right.
And it just so happens that it describes an eternal act of a conquering lion forever prevailing, in that our faith is that prevaileth, the conquering, the overcoming, expressed in faith in the Tewahedo mixing of the word with the living faith, applying it. So we see the Noahday, or the nowadays sign, like His Majesty sitting upon the throne as the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah.
Right.
So, and the symbol, I think what I should try to get to, like, not try to make it long, whatever, is the symbology of the only people that are likened to Israel, Ethiopia, because they upheld the living spirit that is expressed since the very first covenant in Noah, the faith. See, what that flag represents, man, is so significant, in that it expresses the authority in Yehuda in the praises of Jah, praises to Yahweh,
right,
as a form of worship, and it received a change in the times and the spirit of the moment in prophecy, and adapted to the living word. The word was made manifest, and no doubt Ethiopia stretched forth her arms to God, you know, and so they received Christianity. So Judaism proper, real Judaism, fulfilling its duty and to recognize the sign of the times and shift into the new day, receiving Christ as the living word and making that leap of faith from Judaism, and receiving the living word in the spirit of the prophecy in time and becoming Christian. So we have the line of Judah, the old government, the Old Testament ones would say, being transferred to the cross,
right,
carrying his cross,
right,
receiving Christ, Judaism, Judeo-Christianity, in the Tewahedo sense.
Right.
So that's all represented in this flag. Right. The conquering line of Judah hath prevailed, and the prevailing is everlasting. You know, so it's in our confidence of the victory of good over evil.
I mean.
And then it's perfectly expressed in.
In the word, because that's
the root of David, conquering line of tribe of Judah. Conquered lion of the tribe of Judah hath prevailed. To open the book and loose the seven seals, look therein. I may not have quoted correctly, but We get the picture. So all expressed, and that's the thousands of years of independence. That's what we fight for. That's that covenant that is in the Constitution. The whole, like, from the beginning of the book to the end, it's the same Constitution. The Bible and our Constitution. And it's a fulfillment of the whole book, even in the standard, that it explains the story. In the beginning was the Word, you know, and the Word was the light.
Oh,
it was
right.
The same covenant, you know. I mean, just repetition of how unique and creative our Creator is, that He could do the same thing and express it in an eternal sense.
Right.
And it's ever, ever constant, ever, ever whole.
Mm. Right, it's very interesting because Jeremiah is like speaking about the regathering also, and speaking, I mean, it's like the judgment, and I'm trying to see the banner. In this sense, it's banner.
So, I mean, the banner, our standard, really is sustained in the crown government, under the crown's government, or standing in the crown as inheritance, as that unborn child, or that child coming to maturity.
Right, it's in the Constitution.
Yes, it's in the Constitution, and as we have seen, it's expressed clearly, like in the Bible, since the very beginning.
Yeah, it's
same essence.
It's the covenant of the covenant.
And it upholds our standard from the very beginning, from the creation of light.
Right.
Sevenfold perfect spirit, which is all inclusive of our flag. The transfer of covenants from Old Testament to living, to New Testament. And to Rastafari receiving it, as Ethiopians received it from Judaism to Christianity, now from Christianity us to the
the
fullness.
The Constitution is like all the covenants together, it seemed like.
All the laws that govern man, the reign of God. His government, His reign. It's all constitutional. And it's all represented in the flag.
Okay.
So, I think it, what was it? In connection to the throne, one who sat upon the throne, through whom we are even able to act in the knowledge of our flag, representing Rastafari and the faithful Ethiopians. Through him that sits upon that throne, which is in relation to the covenant since the very beginning. Throne in heaven, throne on earth, the divinity in Jesus Christos, and the majesty in Abba Father, the throne on earth, which is revealed in the highlands of Ethiopia. Carefully protected from the evil curiosities of the world, preserved to be a living testimony, but it don't end there. We keep it going. Like Sister Emmanuel says, we keep it moving, and the spirit is ever present, ever growing, ever moving, ever perfecting. So we go with it. So no doubt the whole study of the flag, I mean, just reflects the Constitution.
Yeah, because look, here goes the banner. Okay, it says, this is Jeremiah chapter 50, and speak of the covenant also. Declare ye among the nations, and publish, and set up a standard. The standard, same as the banner. Publish and conceal not. Babylon is taken, Bel is confounded, Merodach is broken in pieces, her idols are confounded, her images are broken in pieces, for out of the north there cometh up a nation against her, which shall make her land desolate, and none shall dwell therein. They shall remove. They shall depart, both man and beast. In those days and in that time, saith Yahweh, the children of Israel shall come, they and the children of Judah together, going and weeping. They shall go and seek Yahweh their Elohim. They shall ask the way to Zion with their faces thitherward, saying, come and let us join ourselves to Yahweh in a perpetual covenant that shall not be forgotten. Oh, this is like a prophecy of now, though, like the things that are going on now with all the lost people. And both Ethiopians being the children of Judah and the children of Israel, like the ones that don't recognize his majesty, and the Ethiopians that don't recognize.
Well, the thing is that you know, like the Christian boy,
yeah.
how he's calling upon the strong, long-haired men, you know.
Right.
It's like to prepare the way, to set up a standard, to be an ensign to the people.
Right, because that otherwise...
To sign to the people, it says, the way.
It says publish. Look, this is the order right here.
The Nazarene baptizes, the Ras Teferi baptizes the Christ. Even though it's a fact, it's a truth and reality in and of itself, but then symbolically, it's like we are to be baptized of him, but you know, ritualistically, it was Samuel that baptized or sprinkled the spirit upon King David, right? Samuel being a Nazarite, a Rastafari type. And so we see the transfer of and even that's a covenant and a transfer of power. But not to go into that, we just to point out the reflection of John the Baptist being a Rastaman type, a Nazarite, and then baptizing Christos, Jesus. And so us now, we're that covenant people that bring in, that raise that standard, that prepare the ways for others to, you know, if it be Jah will that they find themselves in light of his majesty, to Christ.
Yeah. Yes, okay. Yeah. See the standard. Yeah. This is the standard for people to Exodus, because.
And that standard is to lead the people, right?
Right.
So because, who leads the people?
This is the North.
Yehuda leads the people.
Right. But yeah, the standard is
in the wilderness.
Is Yehuda, because, I mean, this is just speaking of the banner of His Majesty specifically, because, This is the North Country prophecy. This is right now. This is like a right now, right now.
Could
right
this
now.
Be?
They seek a way to Zion. Zion is the kingdom of David, right? So, or the Davidic monarchy, and they can't even recognize the Davidic monarchy. And even today, like the certain, I don't know, they don't have the fullness of the covenant, because if they don't recognize the Davidic monarchy, then they rejected Zion. Right?
Yeah.
And Israel, a lot of Israel doesn't even know who Judah are or who the children of Judah are as Ethiopians. And His Majesty, they don't even, they, like Zion, they think is over in Old Jerusalem somewhere, or somewhere up in the sky or something. I mean, it is somewhere up in the sky. It is the heavenly Zion.
In another level of study, right?
Right. In another level of study. And like a spiritual level of study.
Yeah, definitely.
More fitting, but this is, I'm talking about the real manifestation of the five cycle.
In the flesh.
Right. So, you know, that's what this is speaking of. And the standard, that's why it's so important that the proper standard be raised. Because it says this is the word that Yahweh spoke.
Yeah. It must be raised accordingly in its proper order. In my Father's house there is order. And there is a standard, and it's upheld. You pick up your cross.
Because look, it say right here, declare ye among the Goyim. And the goyim and the senses, like, it's also...
The nations, the people.
Yeah, the people and the nations. I don't think it's really in a derogative sense, but this is just to tell people what's going on.
And no doubt, the scattered amongst the people.
Mm.
For you know, it's kind of possible. Why would through Israel the Gentiles receive salvation? Because if there be one, see, that's the plan. Okay, I give thanks to the Most High for this. It's like, that was the plan, you know, scatter Israel amongst the people so that where Israel is, I ain't going to destroy that place because, you know, if there be one, two, you know, righteous, you know, I'll keep it. So through Israel, the Gentiles are saved. So the Gentiles are being called because there are some of us amongst the Gentiles to be called out. Mm. And if through I and I, you know, the Gentiles seek salvation, and so be it, if it be the will of Moses.
Because the goyim, it looked like, I mean, because you know how, you know, all this stuff is being exposed or whatever, all this wickedness and stuff, and a lot of the nations are like, they're seeing their idols being broken, so they're like, you know, right here it says, you know, say Babylon is taken, people are starting to figure out certain confusion and certain truths, but.
Because at this time, Daniel's prophecy already is fulfilled.
Mm.
I would say. And you know, I could be wrong.
I don't know.
Well, what I'm trying to say is that if the idols are already being destroyed, then the dream has certainly already been revealed to the king.
Mm.
So that statue, his majesty at this time in the spirit of prophecy, he already judged all nations. That there is no other government superior one to another except the kingdom of our Lord, the kingdom of heaven, is superior to any other government.
Mm.
Outside of that, everyone is equal. And so he judged every form of government represented in these idols.
Mm. Right, right.
In these false and corrupt establishments or systems.
Right, right, right.
And so that's the only reason I say that. That's how I can support the claim that in this period of time, in prophecy, His Majesty already, it's probably 1963 or something like that, and he's saying 27 years ago.
Right.
Yeah, he's confirming his prophecy.
Mm.
And so he judges once again. Now what are we going to do? Right. You know, like, 27 years ago, I stood before the same world organization that failed to keep covenant, to give meaning to a dead letter.
Right.
I'm gonna read this just for the record.
Okay.
The autobiography of His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie I, Emperor Haile Selassie I, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, Volume 1, 1892 to 1937, translated and annotated by Edward Ohlendorf. Let's see, it's chapter... I gotta drink some water. Chapter 35, titled We Proclaim Immobilization. Page number is... Okay, there's two page numbers. One is in the... inside of the book, towards the inside of the book, that one reads page 195, and towards the outside corner of the book, page number reads 236. It cannot be doubted that to a soldier, a peasant, or a traitor, I guess I have to make the clarification that a traitor, like in a business sense, right? His country's independence is his greatest pride. Actually, it'd be wise to state for the record that this is the covenant of the flag. To uphold the independence, continuing, it is therefore important to convince you, okay, we got to work on that word sound. To convince you to the utmost extent possible that quarrels and deceitfulness amongst you should disappear, that love and unity should spread. Even that's a testimony to this next oath in upholding to the last, even to death if necessary. Our religion, our Christian religion, because it just the wording to the utmost extent possible that quarrels and deceitfulness amongst you should disappear, that love and unity should spread. It's like saying that Christianity should spread, because our love, our unity is loving one another, but not just any love, but how the Son has loved us, love us, love we, I and I.
Amen.
Yes, I.
Yes, I.
And so, it's almost declaring like the next of part of the vow or the oath to defend up to the last our independence, and now it's going to go into the covenantal order, would be our religion, Christian religion, in which it goes further on to say, and that a servant should acknowledge obedience to his master and a soldier to his officer. So the servant being obedient to the Father, and so on and so forth. The Spirit of Christ, really.
Amen. And the Nazarite, because... Yeah, continue?
Go for it.
Oh, just for the record, because, you know, I was watching that video, and it was the covenant, which was given through the Constitution. Although the Constitution was not revised at that time when His Majesty returned to after the liberation and returned to Addis Ababa, and the soldier declared his vow that was fulfilled, who was a Nazarite in the video.
I won. Yes, I.
The...
Sure.
Yeah, the... Ethiopia was never really colonized because, like we said, like I mentioned also, because there was always that flag flying and fighting. So the Nazarite vow, and just to refer to the order of the flag of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah conquering, the Honorable Abebe Aragwe,
yes, sir.
spoke to His Majesty. He was an officer of the army, which he had gave the order not to cut the hair. They were in the afros, as we've seen in the footage, by our brethren Hael Tafari on the channel Education
is the key.
Awo.
Three.
I mean,
education is the key. Three.
Education is the key. Three. There we go.
Because it says three, and then if they don't type that in, it may.
Indeed.
Yes, sir.
And, you know, I'm not sure if I have the entirety correct, but just, you know. And the vow said, he repeated, I never dreamed, or Your Majesty, I never hope the sight of Your face again, which is kind of awkward in the English, but... You know, we could still catch the spirit of it. It said, Your Majesty, I never hope the sight of Your face again. I never dreamed that I'd once more hope to be happy. I was only determined to fight until I died for our, number one, our independence, and then for our flag, and then for our Christian religion, and for You, my King. For the record.
Oh. It was Ababa Ade.
I think Ababa Aragwe.
Aragwe.
Oh.
Aragwe.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, he had mentioned in the video to his his chosen, his people, his numbered. Like his army. He expressed that.
Oh, for our flag. My fault. I'm not sure if I... Just one more time from the top.
Yes, sir.
You care to... I was only determined to fight until I died for our independence, for our flag, for our Christian religion, and for You, my King of Kings, Kedemali Haile Selassie. Last in parentheses.
And that's interesting because it's the Nazarite, like I was saying, Abba Arguay, right? Mm. He was mentioning to his soldiers like that the hair, the afro, is a representation of their separation, and how, not necessarily in those words, but affirming their Nazariteship,
oh,
right? Yes. In that they were distinguished by the growth of their head, right, you know, they're covering their glory, really.
It tied really much with Samson, because it was like to distinguishing that fighting spirit. That's what.
The Esai.
I believe that's what he mentioned. Something to that effect.
Samson and the hair.
Right. That's what came to mind.
Well, no doubt. I mean, but I'm trying to recall something. Let's go forward to the Nazarite. All right, give thanks to the Most High. I kind of caught that idea or thought once more. The reason we went into the whole Nazarite thing is because what he hopes and dreams for is kind of expressed in the blessing to a Nazarite, right?
Oh, indeed. Numbers chapter 6, verse, I think 24 and 26.
So he's saying, if I recall correctly, he's saying, like, I didn't think I'd even, like, see you again.
Yeah, I hope, that. I never hoped to see the sight. I think the sight of your face again. So
I never thought I'd be happy for once more, you know, kind of like that. I'd be happy again.
Yeah, simcha, like.
So I'm reading, the Lord bless thee and keep thee.
Right.
So he's speaking this once the vow or the mission was fulfilled. It's like he's fulfilling his vow, expressing it to the before the face of the emperor.
Yeah, it would be like
king of kings.
No, because there's what's called the call and response, and we see this pattern in the Psalms. So this is that was the actual fulfillment of the call. This would be the, because what happens would be like the cantor, I think they call it the cantor, or the priest, you know, would chant or call to the congregation,
mm-hmm.
and then the congregation would give a response, like in certain psalms we see that pattern. So this would be the call, right? In the real time, this would be the call. Continue reading, brother.
Yes, so we overzap. Let's see how it gets tied in. It reminds me kind of like the blessings and curses.
Mm.
If you're kept by him, in him, through him, for him, and he blesses us, it's like, I'm gonna just go for it. Watch. It says, "The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious to thee."
Mm.
And so, an important thing to note is that the Nazarite vow is already an Israelite that separates himself from Israel.
Mm.
And even symbolically, like, refuses some of the things that represent Israel. And it demonstrating or just entering into covenant with himself, and that Jais is his wine, his happiness. Mm. That which it expresses, like, the natural joys of a man that one could attempt to attain.
Mm.
But one lets go of all of that and, you know, it declares himself in him. Mm. And it's interesting because he says, Abba Arguay, he says, and I'm probably pronouncing it wrong, but anyways, he says that he never thought he'd be happy again, expressing his fullness in Nazariteship.
Mm.
In that his happiness was the face of the emperor. He completely just, like, said, I never thought I'd see your face again.
Right.
I never thought I'd once again be happy. It's like his happiness was the sight of the face of the emperor, the king of kings, his glory.
Because his blessing is like his majesty's blessing, because his majesty being in the priest position on earth, you know, it says, Yahweh bless thee and keep thee. It's like the blessing that kept Abba Arguay while his majesty was away fulfilling the word.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then Yahweh make his face to shine upon thee. And that's exactly what the spirit of Abba Aragwe's sentiments were when he said, the response would be, you know, mm-hmm. Your Majesty, I never hope to see the sight of your face again. You know, and then the fulfillment again is like, Yahweh lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee shalom, and his Majesty gave shalom again to Ethiopia.
And it's interesting.
The flag.
It's interesting how it leads on to say, and they shall put my name upon the children of Israel.
Kedemawi Haile Selassie.
Yes, I, because, I mean, the children of Israel, his name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. So, it's not the children of Israel, Amos, that's the name that Amos, we receive, right?
Amos 9 and 7.
Yes, I.
Because the fullness thereof is, are ye not as the children of the Ethiopians to me, O children of Israel? Which means that when we read there, that establishes that Israel and Ethiopia is so related in the covenant that they're almost interchangeable sometimes.
Yeah, definitely. You know, in the spirit of time and that right. Which has been, is, and will ever be. Yeah, we see that.
Right.
We see that in so many different ways.
Right.
I mean, not to go into that, but
yeah.
Ethiopia and David says something. He says, he asked a question. He says, I can't recall, maybe it's first or second Samuel, chapter 10, chapter 7, I can't recall, to be honest.
Mm.
You know, but says something to the effect of asking a question, who is like thy city? Who is like thine people?
Mm.
He starts asking a question and starts going, who is likened to Israel?
Mm.
And I would add to David, I'd be like David. David most likely knew what people were like. Israel.
Right.
Why would he even mention that if there wasn't a people like Israel to begin with?
Mm.
Right? And who is he addressing?
Right.
Even that's interesting in itself. Mm. But then I would say, hey, you know, it's in Amos.
Right.
The Most High revealed it clearly in Amos.
Mm.
It's, O children of Israel, are ye not as children of the Ethiopians to me? O Israel, something, you know, something to that effect.
Mm.
And that in itself is interesting because the context of that chapter or that area of chapter in the book of the prophet Amos, Amos, it's about the remnant. It's about the regathering. Mm. It's about the second time around. That's the context, and it's completely related to Psalm 72.
Right.
Before them shall bow the Ethiopians, and the enemies, his enemies shall lick the dust. And then later on it goes on to say, and the kings of Saba and Sheba shall bring forth their gifts, possibly gold, myrrh, and frankincense, if not some scripture along with that, you know. But, you know, the Ethiopians, Saba, Sheba, so it's all related, Ethiopia and Israel, in that sense, and the kingdom, and the covenants, and everything.
Right.
And so, who's likened to... What people are like to Israel? Well, Ethiopians.
Right.
And I think I'm going to add another element of that, why I think it's so very important, and it's well evident even if people accept it or not, it's that the fact that Ethiopia was chosen also is to be likened to Israel is because they're the closest thing to what Israel should have been and what was probably at a single time. It's like when the Ethiopian festivals or holy days are being manifested, it's like a lot of commentators in old footage would say, it's like seeing David
right.
dancing around the ark.
Right, right.
It's basically saying that this is the like they said about His Majesty in one of these documentaries, he's practically the incarnation of the history of our time.
Right.
I mean, just think about what that kind of like is trying to imply.
Mm.
The reincarnation or the incarnation, the manifestation of the word of our story, of the word, you know,
right.
of our time in the living spirit, in the living word, or in the spirit of the time within the prophecy.
Mm.
You know, so even that's very interesting.
Right.
But nonetheless, I mean, it's very obvious. Oh, forgive me. You can't. Mm. what I was trying to say with that is that if any other, well, Ethiopia's the only people that upheld the covenant, really. And I was going to say something leaning towards the flesh, because the independence of our standard and flag also plays a role in how you can't confuse the physical appearance of Israel. Because see, if so many things happened, every other kingdom broke covenant, so they no longer have the security of shalom, of keeping the covenant. That in itself is evident. Ethiopia expresses thousands of years of independence. Why would they differ from any other kingdom unless before the Most High they were upholding the covenant? You know?
Right.
So they've been independent ever since, because they've, you know, they're Israel in the real deal, you know.
Right.
Now what's happening with this time? It's a, you know, to keep things holy, you split, you flip, you know, you kind of that's the whole Jah divide, and then he flips the blessings, you know, crosses his hand and stuff like that. So what was I trying to get to now? Kind of lost my thought on that. But going forward to the physical appearance, Ethiopia's independence, you can't say that they look different before. You can't say that, because a lot of people will try to use these not very knowledgeable excuses to say that Israel is not in the flesh of a more, what they would say, black appearance or whatever, ethnically like Ethiopians,
right,
or like Israelites, really.
Right.
But they would say that that's not the case because, oh, it's talking about the Ethiopian, the Bible. Well, Ethiopia has been independent since the Bible was being written. So that argument is completely an error in reasoning. It's a fallacy in logic. It just cannot be, because Ethiopia has never transferred authority to anyone else.
Right.
It's the same Ethiopia 3,000 years ago than it is now. So if there's a comparison with Ethiopia, it's the same comparison that will be to this day, because to this day it maintains some sort of independence. Particularly in the appearance of the people, they have not been infiltrated to the point where everything's really lightened. Although Ethiopia is a place where with different shades of brown or black and stuff like that, we know that, but what I'm referring to is that 100 years pass and then a lot of people look more white. That's what I'm trying to say. Like Egypt, throughout the years. Now you wouldn't even assume that. Well, you could, I mean, if you could think for yourself, right? But a common folk, he won't be able to assess the fact that it's possible a darker people would have been in their stead just 100 years ago.
Right.
So that in itself is a very important connection with Ethiopia, because Ethiopia is independent. You can't say they're not the same Ethiopia. You can't say that Ethiopians were at one point in time something else. No, Ethiopians are who they were 3,000 years ago as they are now. And if there's a comparison made with them, then we have the real deal. You don't have no confusion as to what that similarity is.
Right.
You know? So I think it's important to put out there. Any comments? Well, all this is relative to the flag, really. So we were expressing how even in the autobiography of His Imperial Majesty, the Emperor of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie I, King of Kings of Ethiopia, how it was saying it cannot be doubted to a soldier, a peasant, or a trader, his country's independence is his greatest pride. It is therefore important to convince you to the utmost extent possible that quarrels and deceitfulness amongst you should disappear, that love and unity should spread, and that a servant should acknowledge obedience. That's what Jesus Christus taught us.
Right.
He being a servant, to serve each other and to be a servant of the Most High. And even Edomai Khan Selassie in glory showed us to serve. So the Spirit of Christ. And then continuing on, it said, and that a servant should act on a knowledge of obedience to his master and a soldier to his officer. If the Italians are proud of their weapon against us, we are proud. We, on our part, are proud that our greatest weapon against them is the help of God. And as Wyndham Eisen and I were meditating on, it seems almost very sure in the spirit that this would be a kind of testimony of Christianity. Or was that the I was saying? Help, salvation, Yeshua's salvation.
Oh, yeah, salvation would be understood as salvation. Well, in Hebrew would be Yeshua, and salvation is Yeshua. That's in, as the Hebrew, and His Majesty is Hebrew, and a Christian king would definitely understand that in that context, and not really out of any other context that, you know, it might be misconstrued as.
Yes, I give thanks for that. And so, basically what we're trying to state is the constitution of the flag and how it's upheld, or the constitution and the standing in the flag, right?
Right. It's a recognition, and not only of Yeshua as the Son, but to uphold the true covenant that was given to not only Ethiopia, but that flag, what it represents is the covenant of the kingdom of the Son, but upheld by the Father, seeing that the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, Ketamari Haile Selassie, is the Father, in the ensign, in the emblem, upholding the cross of Jesus Christos.
Yes, sir. Amen. That's actually pretty interesting, the whole Hebrew Christian, because it's another representation of how the flag is being represented within this constitution, even.
Mm-hmm.
In that it's a transfer of power since the beginning, from Noah in the cleansing, well, from the beginning being the light,
mm-hmm.
being that representation of the rainbow,
mm-hmm.
and then to the sign of the covenant through Noah, mm-hmm. the rainbow in faith, through faith, mixing it with mixing the word with living faith, perfect union or tawahido, fusing it, acting on it, and, you know, receiving the covenant that comes from it. And then the symbology of the Lion of Judah and stuff like that. So what I'm trying to say is that all this in connection with the one that sat upon the throne, and one that sat upon the throne, and the throne being in relation with the ark, that same ark, the rainbow, the light since the very beginning,
mm.
right? And so, keeping all that in mind, it shows the transfer of power within all covenants,
mm.
and so it's upholding Christianity, part of our standard.
Mm.
Because Christianity received the transfer of see, the throne, what I'm trying to get to kind of is lay a foundation, somewhat of a foundation, to express that the Kevra Negesh makes known that the throne of Israel, of Yehuda really,
mm.
was established in Ethiopia, mm. the throne, the physical throne on earth,
mm.
and Jesus Christus received the divinity.
Mm.
The Kevra Negesh goes into that.
Oh.
And so, I mean, I was trying to tie it into how, let's see, let me read this again. So, to uphold Christianity, basically.
Mm.
So, it's a Hebrew Christian throne.
Right. It would be the throne. I mean, it is, because it's the King of Israel, you know, and we have evidence for that.
So, the connections, I mean, I'm just trying to brainstorming, right?
Mm.
But the connections of a throne.
Mm.
In that it says, well, if the pair are proud of their weapon against us, then we are proud of the greatest weapon against them is the help of God. We actually kind of slipped on that. Should have gone forward. It says, our flag, red, yellow, and green, and our seal with the legend, the lion has prevailed, are the symbol of our independence, lest this symbol of our freedom should perish It is a great honor for our good name and for our history if we die shedding our blood to the very last drop. And that's exactly the constitution laid out by Ababa Argue, right?
Right. That was his. That was his declaration.
And to sum it up, I would say that as Rastafari, we must overstand that that's our standing in the flag. We must, to the very last, shed our, even if necessary, our blood to the very last drop and suffer and die, if Jah will, to uphold, maintain our independence. Could you help me out with the other ones? It was
our
independence, our flag.
Our flag, our Christian religion, and for the King of Kings, Kenamawi Haile Selassie. And we could spend some bit of time going into details, but refer to the speeches of His Majesty speaking about liberty, our liberty, not just whatever idea of liberty ones and ones might have, but our Christian liberty and the willingness to, if necessary, lay down one's life for it.